With me today, Michel Odom, who has been a surgeon and has been in charge of the surgical and maternity unit of the Pithiviers Hospital in France from 1962 to 1985. Odont has developed a special interest in environmental factors influencing the birth process. Now he is retired in London, but one of the main part of his career has been influenced by the concept of home-liking birthing rooms, birthing pools, and singing session for pregnant women. After his hospital career, he was involved in home birth, founding in London the Primal Health Research Center and designed a database. Dear Michel, I am very honored, happy to have you with me today to talk about your life. Thank you for being here. I would like to start with a simple question. What is the aspect of your life of which you are more proud?
More proud.
Proud.
Perhaps the way I was born in 1930 at home. The labor started at 10 o'clock at night, and I was born at midnight, and at home, of course, at that time. And my mother used to say that the day of my birth was the most joyful day of her life. So perhaps I can say I'm proud of that.
From this introduction, I can really see what a singular personality, original, you have. And so I already feel that this interview will be really amazing. And I will continue to ask you, what is the experience in your full panorama of being in contact with pregnant women that you remember most as a significant moment of your life?
I think a significant part of my life is when I have realized, I've understood something that was not well known at that time. I understood that human beings have been programmed to find the breast during the hour following birth. I understood that during the hour following birth, if the mother gave birth without any drug, without any medication, the baby is expressing what is called in English the rooting reflex. In French, le réflexe de fouissement. It's like that. It's like that. Baby is doing that. That's the rooting reflex. So I understood that the human beings is programmed to do that. So if at that time the Muslim mother is not under the effect of drugs, if she feels free, if she does not feel observed, if she's not distracted by other people, at that time, the mother who's still on another planet, as if on another planet, when giving birth, at that time the mother knows what to do. When baby is doing that, the mother knows what to do. And I understood that it's as if among human beings, the lactation is supposed to start during the hour following birth. I said that for the first time in Italy in November 1977 at a conference in Rome. I explain what can happen if the birth is not too socialized, if the mother is completely free, if she's not distracted, if she gave birth without drug. So I came to the conclusion in this conference that among humans, lactation is supposed to start during the hour following birth. This is something we had forgotten for about 10,000 years since the beginning of the socialization of childbirth. You know, about 10,000 years ago, our ancestors started to dominate nature, domestication of plants, of animals, and domestication of human beings as well. Before that time, before agriculture, before animal husbandry, before the domination of nature, before the domestication of human beings, women used to isolate themselves to give birth. But after that, birth was socialized, was under the control of the cultural milieu. And there were myths, rituals, different ways to interfere and to delay the initiation of breastfeeding. For example, to say that the colostrum is what a baby can find in the breast immediately after birth. People used to say colostrum is not good for the baby. So from that time until we can say the end of the 20th century, we had forgotten that baby can find the breast during the hour following birth. It was commonplace to delay the initiation of breastfeeding. So this is probably the most important part of my life, and interesting that I talk about that with you, because the first time I spoke about that in a medical conference was in Rome.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Michel. I wanted to ask you also how important is the way we are born in relationship with the person we become?
It's an important question. Difficult to provide precise answers. But what we can say for sure, as a way to start, that the period surrounding birth is probably the phase of human life that has been the most dramatically modified, transformed during the past decades. Easy to summarize what's happening now, today. Today, at a global level, at the level of the whole planet, most women have babies without releasing a cocktail of hormones, a mixture of hormones. Women originally were supposed to release hormones to have babies, oxytocin, endorphin, prolactin, and so on. Now, most of them have babies without releasing these hormones because birth is too socialized. We have at our disposal medications replacing hormones, synthetic oxytocin. We have at our disposal safe technique of cesarean section. So what happens and what's new and so important today at a global level, most women don't need to release a cocktail of hormones, which is a cocktail of hormones of love, to give birth to the baby and to the placenta. Women are supposed to release a cocktail, a mixture of hormones of love to have babies. This mixture, we know that. But today, they don't need it. And most women don't release them. So it's something new. in the history of mankind that hormones of love have been made useless, redundant, useless in the period surrounding birth. No need for hormones of love to have babies. That's a turning point in the history of mankind. This is a reason for questions. What are the possible effects on our species? Not about, forget individuals, but let's think in terms of our species, human species, if love hormones are useless at that time. Also, we're at a time when scientists consider the period surrounding birth as critical in the formation of human beings. Critical means it's a short period of time, but with important long-term consequences. So this is we can say. Having said that, for sure, the question is, but what are the possible long-term effects and what are the possible effects at the level of our species of disturbing at such a point, modifying at such a point, the period surrounding birth. So we are at a time for questions. The point at the present time is not to answer. Well, difficult to study, difficult to answer, but to phrase the appropriate question. And when saying that, I feel obliged to show you the cover of my last book. You see the cover. What do you see on the cover?
Oh, it's very nice. It's very nice.
So it means you are right to raise this question. This is what we have to do at the present time. Let's phrase appropriate questions in unprecedented situations. And don't rush to provide answers. Don't rush to have theories, ideas, and so on and so on. The first, we are at a time when we have to train ourselves to phrase, formulate appropriate questions in unprecedented situations. That's a radically new situation. Whatever the topic, you know, you can think of the effect of human activities on the climate. You can think of pollution of the ocean, anything. We are in a new situation. What can we do today? Phrase appropriate questions. Don't rush to provide answers. Don't have theories. Don't wait for theories. Raise questions. That's exactly the meaning of my latest book. I showed you the cover of the original edition in English. I can tell you that an Italian edition will be published soon.
Oh, great.
It has been translated into Italian by Clara Scropeta. You know her. And it will be an updated edition because this one was published in October 2019. The Italian edition will be published in 2020. So there are two more chapters and it's a little bit updated.
Thank you, Michel. Thank you. We will wait for this book because I can really see that you moved from a very important topic, from your professional surgeon to being close to the women, and now you are embracing the whole human species by this book, because you are making the uncomfortable questions. But as listening to you, I understand that in some way, when we are born, we usually became initiated to the hormones of love. It's like starting to know something very important. How do we experience these hormones of love then in as we grow?
Yes, yes, it's what we talk today about love. When we try to understand how the capacity of love develop, we are obliged to focus on this critical period, to focus on what happens at birth. We are obliged to do that. People have not yet realized this important point. And if you start from that, and if you train yourself to phrase appropriate questions, you realize that since our ancestors have domesticated human beings, have socialized childbirth, we have completely lost what's happening when a woman is giving birth. Suddenly, we realize that we have to rediscover the basic need of laboring women. In other words, we have to learn a different way about birth physiology. Today, one reason why we don't understand the birth process, one reason why we don't understand the birth physiology, that we start from a wrong question. It's always the same story. Let's start from good questions. At the present time, we start from a wrong question. If you read books, textbooks, or midwives, doctors, and so on, the question is, the primary question is, why are human births difficult? Let's start from that. And immediately, the answer is difficult for mechanical reasons. They show pictures of the size of the skeleton of the mother and the shape of the bones of the mother, pictures of the head of the baby. They say for mechanical reasons, human births are difficult, full stop. If you start like that, you don't need to say more, because you cannot change the shape, the size of the bones of a mother when she's pregnant. You cannot do anything. So people are not curious about birth physiology. It's another matter to start from another question. The useful question, why occasionally human birth is easy and fast? We know that all of us are stories, but women, we are not special in terms of size, shape of their bones, and so on. They are like everybody. But occasionally, there are such women who give birth easily, quickly, don't need for any pharmacological assistance to babies. We should start from this question. Why human births occasionally are easy? The important point is from which question we start. If you start from that, and the age of modern neurophysiology, another scientific context, you realize that until now, we have overestimated, we have estimated in excess, we have too much overestimated the mechanical problems, the morphological problems, the mechanics. And we realize that to understand the birth process among humans, we have to recall what makes human beings special compared with all the other mammals. What makes us special is the huge development of our brain, particularly this part of the brain we call the new brain, the so-called neocortex. The human neocortex is enormous compared with the neocortex of other mammals, for example. That's why we can communicate in sophisticated ways, even with internet and so on, because our neocortex, we can create many new things. We can communicate with writing, send human beings to to the moon, to mathematics and so on. So this is the huge development of the neocortex. So the point is that until recently, this huge neocortex, this powerful neocortex, new brain, was presented as a tool, an instrument, a tool at the service of vital functions, providing information about space, time, facilitating communication. Today, suddenly, thanks to neurophysiologists, we understand it's not like that. In fact, it's not always like that. In some situations, on the contrary, the powerful neocortex can inhibit, can obscure, can make more difficult some human physiological functions. It's a new way to understand human nature. The concept of neocortical inhibition, a key concept to understand human nature. How the thinking brain, the logical brain, when very active, can be a handicap, So we understand that for many physiological functions. For example, if you drink a glass of wine, alcohol, you reduce the activity of the neocortex and your sense of smell is more powerful. The sense of smell was inhibited by the activity of your rational brain. It's an example to explain what it means. So having understood that, we can reach a key for understanding other physiological functions, in particular, the birth process. Today, we can understand the solution that nature found to make human birth possible and even possibly easy. The human birth is impossible as long as the cortex, the brain of the rational brain, is active. As long as you are thinking too much, as long as women are thinking too much, not too logical, too active, they cannot give birth. The solution nature found to make human birth possible is occasionally easy, is to reduce neocortical activity, to stop thinking. And this can still be understood today by some people, some midwife occasionally, very small number of people, but there are people who can easily understand that. There are people who know that when a woman is giving birth easily by herself, she's as if cutting herself off from her world, forgetting everything, forgetting what she read, forgetting her plans, forgetting what she had been told and so on. She's cutting herself from her world, forgetting everything. She dares to, she can behave in a way that usually would be unacceptable regarding a civilized woman. For example, she dares to scream, to swear. She can behave in a strange way. She can find herself in the most primitive postures, often like animals, like mammals, on forehands, or on hands and knees, you know, bizarre postures. A sense of smell can be very powerful. That's a good sign that she has reduced neocortical activity. This is a solution nature found to make human birth easy and possible. The solution to that is provided by neurophysiologists. This is the only thing we have to understand and to have to go the step forward. If you understand that, you understand what are the basic needs of a laboring woman. You cannot help a woman to give birth. You cannot help an involuntary process. that lesson from modern physiology. But what you can do is to protect the Liberian woman against all possible stimulation of her neocortex. In a modern scientific context, the key word is protection. Forget helping, guiding, controlling, coaching, and so on and so on. Managing, as a doctor said. Coaching is much more in group promoting natural childbirth. Managing is much more about doctors. It's the same way of thinking. It's cultural conditioning. Many doctors, people promoting natural childbirth, is the same way of thinking. It's cultural conditioning. They want to help. In modern physiology, you can only protect against inhibitory factors, factors that can make it more difficult, factors that can stimulate neocortical activity. What does it mean? It's simple. It means don't talk to a woman in labor. She will have neocortex. Be careful with light. Light stimulates the neocortex, inhibits the release of the darkness hormone called melatonin. Be careful that the attention of a woman in labor is not attracted by something. For example, if she feels observed, she will pay attention to herself. If she's scared about something, her attention will be stimulated. So the conclusion is simple. The point is to understand that when a woman is in labor, she must be protected. The key word is protected. It's a new way of thinking. Women need to be protected against all possible stimulations of her thinking brain, of her neocortex. It's a new way, suddenly a new way of thinking. It's one reason to be optimistic. It is that at a time when most women cannot release hormones of love to have babies for so many reasons, suddenly we can hope that if we listen to neurophysiologists, we can reach a turning point and to enter a new paradigm, a new way of thinking. And this is something I can say in general. Today, whatever the topic, we have reached the limits of the domination of nature, whatever the topic. Talk about climate, about anything. We have reached the limits of the domination of nature. It's as if we are at the edge of the precipice. We have what can we do to take another direction? And it's not utopian today, thanks to, in particular, to modern physiology. If we accept to understand what we are learning by neurophysiologists and other scientists, there are many new scientific studies, emerging scientific studies that can provide useful information today. We must rely on what we can learn from emerging and fast-developing scientific disciplines to take another direction, not to fall down in the precipice. We're at the edge of the precipice. Let's take another direction. So this was a fast summary on the situation in which we are today. That's the kind of question we have to raise at the present time if we wonder about what is the future, what is the future of Homo. We must dare to listen to this emerging scientific discipline.
Thank you, Michel. Thank you. By listening to you, I can see how much alive you are, how much you have passion for what you do, for what you explain. So I would like to ask you something that is not really on what you have studied and teached, but I would like to know from you what is the secret of getting along with age in a very positive, passionate way.
So I often give a very fast answer, and particularly today, because it's the end of our meeting, my answer is, I have chosen my mother carefully.
Very good, very good. So what is your suggestion for those who have to come and born again in this life? This is the best
I don't make suggestion. I always I suggest questions.
So Michel, can we close this interview with your hope for the future of OMO?
Yes. So what is your question? It's a question.
What is the future of OMO for you? What is your hope?
I don't know. I don't know. For most questions, my answer is, I don't know. The important is to phrase the question. You know, when you are in an unprecedented situation, for example, today, with the coronavirus and so on, there are three kinds of people. Those who know, I know that. Those who think that, they have seen that. And those who don't know. I belong to the group of people who don't know. I phrase questions. That's all, but I don't know. Let's go.
Okay, Michel, and what is your prayer for humanity?
What is my
prayer for humanity?
Prayer. I prefer to phrase questions rather than to pray.
Thank you very much. There is something you want to say to the people who have listened or is listening to this interview?
I met something very simple. Thinking in particular to women who are expecting a baby. What do they need to know? We can summarize what they need to know. They need to know that to give birth to a baby, they need to release hormones, particularly a hormone called oxytocin. And the only thing they need to know, it is that oxytocin is a shy hormone, a timid hormone. It does not appear among observers and amongst strangers. So the only thing women need to know, the most important thing women need to know, to give birth, you must release the shy hormone.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Michel. Thank you. Thank you to all the people who are listening to it. And we wish you a lot of hormones of love in your life.
Thank you. Have a good day.